Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Young Israel Jamaica Estates, where tonight CHAZAQ is once again honored and privileged to host world-renowned lecturer and author. Let's give a nice loud round of applause to Rabbi Paysach Krohn. Before we begin tonight's inspiring event and lecture with Rabbi Krohn, just a few quick announcements and thank yous, then we're going to call upon the Maggid of the show, Rabbi Hochberg, to say words of welcome as well. Regarding upcoming events and programs, before I get to that, I wanted to give a big thank you to the shul for opening its door. Young Israel Jamaica States, thank you very, very much. I wanted to thank the two sisters, Esther and Sarah, for helping organize tonight's event. Thank you very much as well. You definitely deserve a round of applause. And Izzy Pasquitz and the entire CHAZAQ staff for helping out as well for arranging all the details of tonight's event. Tonight's event is dedicated to Ilui Nishmas in memory of Yochai Ben Frecha, right? Upcoming events and programs. Save the date. I'll start off with a big announcement. And don't miss out Wednesday night, September 9th, CHAZAQ's third annual dinner at the newly renovated terrace in the park. We are going to be honoring Rabbinic Leadership Award, Rabbi Yitzchak Oldbaum, Youth Leadership Award, Simcha Moshev, Hakar Sittov Award, Moshe Stein, Community Service Award, Manny Bahar, Ketitor Award, Alicia Hissinger, and Pillar of Chesed Award, Mr. Ms. Robert Gurgov. This is our main fundraiser of the year. In order for all of these programs that we do, the live events and the CD distribution, the Torah libraries and the Teens Division, the Women's Division, the Radio and the Magazine, the Parsha Papers, etc., 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 in order for us to continue all that. So please try your best to come. If for whatever reason you cannot make a reservation and come in person, please do take out a journal ad. That would be very much appreciated. A week from tonight, CHAZAQ will be teaming up with Or Nava to bring Avinu Malkeinu, the annual night of awakening, to Queens. We're going to be having Charlie Harari, Rabbi Zachariah Warston at the Young Israel of Kew Garden Hills. Tickets are for sale, $18, $36, and $50. So you'll see flyers and emails and details all over the community. Please do save the date for that. CHAZAQ pre-Rosh Hashanah suit sale to benefit our different programs will be this Motzei Shabbos Sunday, a week from tonight, and next Motzei Shabbos on Sunday, August 29th, August 30th, September 5th, and September 6th at the Yeshiva Central Queens YCQ. We're going to be having, obviously, suits. We're going to be having Borsellino hats for only $150, suit jackets, wool dress pants, woven silk ties, shirts, raincoats, belts, etc. for amazing prices. Once again, the proceeds will be going to CHAZAQ. September 2nd, CHAZAQ will be having Rabbi Benjamin Schaefer. And I don't want to go on with the different events and programs. We do have a lot of them. Rabbi Gabriel Sassone, the father who unfortunately lost his children in the massive fire in Brooklyn, will be speaking for CHAZAQ as well, September 21st, 24 hours before Yom Kippur. You're going to see the flyers and the signs all over the community. Visit our website, CHAZAQ.org, CHAZAQ.org, for all these upcoming events and programs. We will also give out a signing sheet where you could fill out your information. I know when I speak, the ladies and the gentlemen, they stare at me as if like, what's wrong with this guy? He's talking so fast. I just don't want to take up so much of your time and continue with all these announcements. So that's why I'm rushing. And we, you know, you came to hear Rabbi Paysach Krohn, and we're going to be having the words of welcome right now from the Maggid Series, Rabbi Hochberg, Shlomo Hochberg. Please, without further ado, Rabbi Shlomo Hochberg, words of welcome, please.
Thank you. I came to hear Rabbi Krohn. I'm sure you all did. I didn't come to hear me, but just a couple of words. One, first of all, great thanks to Rabbi Meirov. He's always amazing to me that every time I look around, there's another program, another program, another program. And I think of, we always say, by Kodesh Baruch Hu, Hinei lo yonav lo yishan shemrei Yisrael, the Guardian of Israel never sleeps. That's what I think about you. I think the same about my wife. But always working, thinking, what's the next thing to apply to Rabbi Krohn is really the same. One idea actually from yesterday's parsha was still allowed. Lo tokim l'chol matzeva. We're not supposed to hate. We're not supposed to make a matzeva. Asher sonesh mokev. Hashem hates a matzeva. Why does Hashem hate a matzeva? Avraham Yitzchak Yaakov made a matzeva. So Moshe Feinstein points out, when Avraham Yitzchak Yaakov made a matzeva, they had no mitzvahs per se. Whatever they did, they take credit for, so they could make a matzeva, which is all about what you did in the past. But when it comes to us, we're not supposed to think about the past. We're supposed to think about the future. We're not supposed to be nitzavim, not supposed to stand. We're supposed to be hochid. When I think of Rabbi Krohn, I look forward every time to Rabbi Krohn, live, in person, all kinds of technological equipment to read. There's always something to think about, what to improve our lives about the future. I look forward very much to hearing Rabbi Krohn. It's a great privilege that you're here this evening.
Without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, let's give them now a round of applause for Rabbi Paysach Krohn.
Mohel has good hands. Okay, you got it? No, it's not going. Mr. Pearl, I need you.
It's good that the mic is not slippery, right?
I hope it's going to be good. Okay, fine. I'm deeply grateful to Rabbi Yaniv Meirov for inviting me to come to speak to all of you at CHAZAQ. As Rabbi Hochberg mentioned, he's a person that is always doing for Klal Yisrael, and it's just incredible how many events CHAZAQ has throughout the year. It's an honor as well to speak in front of Rabbi and Mrs. Hochberg. I know they came from a simcha to try to be here on time, and I'm honored. Very nice, thank you. And then, of course, it's always special to see so many of you. I feel so close to many of you. But there's one little girl that I want to mention. Now, this little girl is so special to me. Her name is Devota Leuterman, and she brought me a Lashana Tova card. This card now will be seen throughout the world, because TorahAnytime.com is all over the world. But this card is so special to me. Do you know why? Because this is not the only thing. Here, come close. Take a beautiful picture of it. Because every time she comes to a lecture, a couple days later, her mother or her grandmother delivers a picture of what the lecture was all about. So whatever I do verbally, she does artistically. So Devora, I just want to tell you that it's very special to me, and that's why I had you autograph this. So I'll hang it up in my dining room for Rosh Hashanah. All of you know that I am a mohel. I've had the great schus to do many, many brisin in this shul itself. And it's very interesting. Why do we name a boy at a bris? We name a girl in shul by an aliyah. Why dafka do we name a boy at a bris? Where does that come from? And the answer is because Avram Avinu, before he had his bris, Hashem says to him, V'lo yikarei oid eshimcha Avram. From now on, your name is not going to be Avram anymore. V'hayashimcha Avraham. Your name is going to be Avraham. And Hashem changed Avram's name as he was about to have a bris, and he added the letter He from Avram to Avraham. And the question is, why dafka the letter He? Why did Hashem pick, of all the letters, of the 22 letters in the Jewish alphabet, why did he pick the letter He? And it's very interesting. Before Avram actually does the bris, Hashem says, you know what? I'm going to change your wife's name also. Vayomer Elohim el Avram, Hashem says to Avram, Sarai ishtecha, your wife Sarai, lo tikra eshemoi Sarai, she's not going to be called Sarai anymore, ki Sarah shema. She's also going to get a new name, and she is also going to have the letter He in her name. So why is it, of all the 22 letters, Hashem picks a He for Avram, and then he can't pick any other letter for Sarai? She has to have also the same letter He. What's so special about the letter He? And I'll tell you what I think. There's a very interesting Gemara in Masechta Menachos, Chav Tes Amud Beis, and it says like this, that Hashem created the world with the letter He. What does that mean, that Hashem created the world with the letter He? All of us know He has a roof and then a line on the side, no floor on the bottom, and the little leg on the side. And the Medrash says, you know what it means? That He is the easiest letter to pronounce. He, just breathe it out. You see, for the other letters that you want to pronounce, for example, if you want to say the letter Pei, you have to have lips. If you don't have lips, you can't say Pei. Or if you want to say Shin, you need teeth to say a Shin. Your eye peach, you can't say Shin. Right? So every letter, Yud or Ches, especially the way the Sfardim say Ches, you need a throat to say Ches. But He is the easiest letter. Hey, just breathe it out.
So that's what the Medrash means. That's what the Medrash explains. That's the pshat, that Hashem created the world. For him, it was so easy, just like the letter He. But there's a different Gemara. And the Gemara explains like this. And this is the reason that I believe that Hashem gave the letter He to Avram and to Sarai. The letter He has no floor. That means, the Gemara says, that when a person does an Avera, he could fall all the way down. There's no end to the amount that a person could fall. But a person has to know, especially now, that the door, there's a little door open, and that door is open for tshuva. No matter how far a person fell, no matter what a person did the past year or the previous years in his life, he should never feel despondent. That little door is open for tshuva. And that's why I believe Hashem gave the hay to Avram Avinu, because he brought all the men back to tshuva. And Sarai brought all the women back to tshuva. So it had to be the letter hay. Now we're going to see something so incredible from the tour, Arachayim, the tour who wrote the Shulchan Aruch. And you would think a Hasidic Rebbe wrote this. But listen to this. V'habrocha, the bracha Hashivenu. Hashivenu is the fifth bracha. Hashivenu is the bracha of tshuva in Shemay Nesra. Hashivenu avinu l'sarasecha, v'karvenu mankeinu l'avarasecha, v'achzirenu b'tshuva shlema. Every day we ask Hashem to bring us back to tshuva. What bracha is that in Shemay Nesra? Number five. Hey, right? Hey is equal five. And the Torah says, it begins with a hey, Hashivenu avinu, and then it ends with a hey, horoitza b'tshuva. So why does the bracha begin with a hey and end with a hey? You know why? Because 5 and 5 is 10, and that's the aseres yemei tshuva. That's the ideal time to do tshuva. So as we approach Elul, and we approach the aseres yemei tshuva, we have to know that we are now about to walk in to that door of tshuva. That's the purpose of our getting together here tonight. To know that no matter what happened in the past, forget about it, as they say in Brooklyn, on the Belt Parkway, right? Forget about it, okay? Right now, we are going to be able to take a walk. We're going to take a trail, a path, into that little door of tshuva. Because no matter whatever happened in the past, we have a hope for the future. And I'll tell you something very interesting. Sometimes a person might feel that, you know, it's difficult to do tshuva. And a person might feel they're afraid. And you know something? There's a fabulous, fabulous Hasidic Vort on the Pasuk in Amos. Aryeh Shog. Aryeh, it's in Amos Gimel Pasuk Ches. Aryeh Shog. If a lion roared, imagine you're walking on 188th Street, right? Or you're walking on Hillside Avenue, Union Turnpike, or whatever. All of a sudden you see a lion roar. Wouldn't you be afraid? Aryeh Shog. If a lion roars, Mila Yira, wouldn't you be afraid? So Hasidic Svarim say, you know what Aryeh stands for? Aleph Reish Yud Hey Elul Rosh Hashanah Yom HaKippurim and Hashanah Rabbah. Imagine that. Aryeh. Those 4 days, those days of trepidation. Elul, Rosh Hashanah, Yom HaKippurim, Hashanah Rabbah. Those 4 periods of trepidation. Those 4 days, those 4 periods of seriousness. Wouldn't we be afraid? Aryeh Shog, Mila Yira? And that's why sometimes a person might be afraid. Oh, how am I going to do tshuva? These days are so awesome. I'm frightened by these days. So I want to tell you that we all have the capacity to do tshuva. You know why? Because what did Bilam say about the Jewish people? Hein om kilavi yokum. We are like a young lion. We can get up and roar back. Aryeh Shog, it's true. These days of Elul, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, Hashanah Rabbah, they're roaring to us. But you know something? A Jew has the capacity to roar back. We should never be afraid. We're hesitant. We're fearful, but we can fight back. And that's what tshuva is all about. And I'll tell you something very interesting. This is a very famous Hasidic Shavuot that I told you about Aryeh Shog Mila Yira. So my Rav, Rav Shlomo Tanabam, on the night of Kol Nidre, once asked this question. He told this, it was adorable. He said, you know, last year on Chol HaMoed Sukkos, I took my children, he said, to the Bronx Zoo. And there was a lion that was roaring. And nobody was afraid. So what is the pasuk talking about? And he said, you know why the lion roared and nobody was afraid? Because it was in a cage. And if it was in a cage, then there was a distance between you and the lion. You had nothing to be afraid of. So he said that for us to really feel Elul, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and Hashanah Rabbah, there can be no iron bars between us and Hashem. We have to connect to Hashem. We have to make a connection to Hashem. Because if we, Chas V'Shalom, Kav Yochel, put Hashem in a cage, and we say, you know, that's a very nice thing, but it's not for us, then we're not going to be afraid. So there can be no mechitza between us and Hashem. And we have to be able to connect with Hashem. And I'll tell you something very interesting. What does it mean to connect to Hashem? I'll tell you a very nice story that Rabbi Yisach Friend once told over years ago. He said that there was a fellow who had gone to visit Ravelvo Soloveitchik. Now we know the Soloveitchiks are geniuses. Ravelvo Soloveitchik was the Godel Hador. This was in the early 1950s. And this was a lawyer who had come to visit him from New York. So they get into a conversation, and Ravelvo asks him, "No, so what are you?" So he said, "I'm a lawyer. I practice law in New York." And they go on to a conversation, they're talking, and a few minutes later, Ravelvo Soloveitchik again asked the fellow, "What are you?" So the guy was surprised. I mean, you're talking about Ravelvo Soloveitchik, the Godel Hador. He just told him 5 minutes ago that he was a lawyer. So he said, "Rebbe, I'm a lawyer in New York." Now, of course, Ravelvo Soloveitchik had asked him this question because he wanted to see how the person is going to respond, and he wanted to teach him something. And he said, "You know something? That's not how a Jew answers the question." And the guy didn't know what he was talking about. And Ravelvo told him, "Take out the Sefer Yonah." Now, we're going to read Yonah on Yom Kippur. And watch this, an amazing thing. We all know the story. Yonah is on the boat, and the boat is rocking, and the boat is shaking, and everybody is frightened that the boat is going to capsize, that it's going to break apart, and everybody's going to drown. And they're trying to figure, something is wrong with somebody on this boat. You know why? Because there aren't any stormy waters out in the ocean. You know, 30, 40 feet away, the water was calm, but only around the boat. That means there's somebody on this boat, you know, that Hashem is angry at. That's how they knew that something was wrong with somebody on this boat, because the other waters were not stormy. Vayomer Elov, and they go to each person, and they go to Yonah. Hagid Elonu, they tell us, Ma Malachtecha, what's your job? What are you? What do you do? And listen to what Yonah answers. Vayomer Aleihem, Ivri Anoichi, I am a Jew. I am a Jew, V'yas Hashem, Elokei HaShemayim, Ani Yorei, and I fear God. Now, what was the question? They asked him, Ma Malachtecha, what do you do? What's your profession? So he didn't say, I'm a lawyer. He didn't say, I'm a prophet. He said, I am a Jew, and I serve Hashem. And listen what the Radak says. Kivon Sha'omar, as soon as he said, Hashem, Elokei HaShemayim, Ani Yorei, I fear God, Heishiv lohem al shelosam. That's the answer, Mama Lachtcha. What do you do? We all have to bring money home. One person could be a negotiator. Another person could be a diamond dealer, a real estate lawyer. Everybody's got a job, but that doesn't define you. Your job does not define you. Mama Lachtcha, what are you? Ivri Anoichi. I am a Jew. Ves Hashem alakei aniyorei. That's how you answer the question, what are you? You're not defined by your job. Today a guy could be a bus driver, tomorrow he could be the head of a company. Everybody's different. The job doesn't define you. And I think it's very important to know that your job doesn't define you and your clothes don't define you. I remember one time I was traveling with my wife. We were traveling through an airport someplace, and I had one of these roll-on suitcases or whatever, roll-on luggages, and it was making a tremendous amount of noise, you know, with the wheels. It was clacking. It was like so embarrassing. So my wife said to me, "Isn't it embarrassing, you know, these wheels?" I said, "I'm not my wheels. You know, that's the problem of the luggage company that made it, not me. I'm not my wheels. I have to be embarrassed because the wheels aren't working? It's not me. Ma malachtecha, what are you? Ivri anoichi." And that's how we connect to Hashem. And when there's no cage and there's no iron bars, then aryeh shog, then taka, these days, this period of time, makes a roshim on us. And I'll tell you something. Rabbi Friend mentioned, he said that after he told that story, there was a stockbroker who wrote him a letter and said, I want you to know, after you told that story, I had a paperweight made and I put it on my desk, because every time I was on the phone, I wanted to look at that paperweight. And you know what it said on the paperweight? Ivri Anoichi. So when I'm now about to make a deal or to talk about a commission that might not be the most honest, I look at that Ivri Anoichi. That's the definition who I am. And that's the definition of what we all are. And that when we walk in the street, we have to know that we represent every Jew in the world. The way you drive on a highway, the way you shop in a grocery store, if you cut somebody off on the line, they don't think it's just you. They don't even know who you are. But they know you're a Jew. You can't hide it. Snood, no snood, shaitel, no shaitel, white hat, black hat, small hat. They know. Every place you go, they know. You can't hide it. And if you can't hide it, then you know, Ivri Anoicha, you represent everyone. I'll tell you a story that happened with my mechutin, Alex Kramer. I have a mechutin who many years ago worked for the Bayer Pharmaceutical Company. He was in the computer department. And one time they had a convention and he had to go because he was one of the top people in the computer department. Where was the convention? In Cologne, Germany. Who wants to go to Cologne, Germany? No Jew wants to go to Germany if he doesn't have to. So he's sitting in this huge dining hall. I don't know if he was wearing a yarmulke or not. I didn't ask him. It's not my business. Among all the goyim. And of course, he couldn't eat anything, so maybe he had a fruit or something, or a glass of water. And he loves classical music. So he told me that there was a strolling violinist that was playing music throughout the dining room, and he's going from table to table and just playing music. And he loves music, so he knew Mozart and Beethoven and Wagner and all those, everybody. And then he told me that as the strolling violinist came up to his table, he took one look at him and he started playing Hava Nagila. He thought he would drop dead. How does that guy know I'm a Jew? I didn't say anything. And that's what made me believe that probably, I don't even know if he was wearing his yarmulke, and I'm not blaming anybody. But the point is, here he's in Cologne, Germany, 1,000 people in that big dining room, and this guy, this strolling violinist, he picks out who the Jew is and he's playing Hava Nagila. So you can't hide it. So Ivri Anoichi, wherever you go, just remember the way you tell jokes in the office, the way you do your business, Ivri Anoichi. And we have to make a connection to Hashem. And if that's the case, I brought a gift for each one of you. Because this is a way how we're going to start doing tshuva. Tonight by Meiriv, and tomorrow by Shacharis, and forever from now on. But I want to tell you a little story. We all know what happened a little over a year ago with Naftali, Gilad, and Ayal. Right? Those three precious boys, Nebach, that were taken. And I must tell you, I always wondered, why did Hashem make it that for 18 days we did not know what happened to those boys? You would think Israeli detectives, the police work, somehow they could have found them. They could have found out what happened. But for whatever reason, Hashem did not allow anybody to know where they were for 18 days. And I believe I know the answer. Because, you know, I was in Zurich during those 18 days. I will never, ever forget the Friday night in one of the Hasidic shuls where I davened Friday night, right before Kabbalah Shabbos, the Gabbai got up. Now, everybody there had a shtreimel, a bekesha, an upturned hat, a gartel. I was the only one that looked like me. The only one. And everybody was Hasidic there. And the Gabbai gets up before Kabbalah Shabbos. He says, now we're going to say Tillim for the three boys. And the Tillim that was said by those Hasidic people was so strong and so powerful, I tell you, I started crying. I was amazed. You know why? Because it occurred to me, I'll bet, 5 weeks ago, if any of these guys here in that show would have seen those three guys with the kippah for gold in those areas where none of us usually live, who knows if they would talk to them. A different type of Jew, right? But now we were all brothers and sisters, and everybody was davening as if it was their own child. And that's why I believe for 18 days Hashem made it, that there was tremendous achdus in Klal Yisrael, and that's why I believe that of the thousands and thousands of rockets that Hamas shot, if you think about it mathematically, it makes no sense. How could not one shul have been blown up? How could people have not been killed? One little boy was killed in Ashdod from shrapnel, which is terrible, but there were thousands of bombs. How could it happen? Mathematically, it doesn't make sense. You send thousands of bombs into another country and nobody gets killed? How does it happen? You know why? Because Hashem made it. Because of such achdus and such togetherness that the tefillos were answered and nobody was harmed because of those bombs. But let me tell you what happened at the end of the 18 days. At the end of the 18 days, when everybody found out what happened, somebody I know went to be Menachem Mavel, Mrs. Frankel, the mother of Naftali. And if you remember, she's a very articulate woman. And she said the most amazing thing. She said at the end, she had a partial nechama, a partial consolation. And people couldn't understand what consolation. She lost a child. What is worse in life than losing a teenage child? And listen to what she said. She said, for 18 days, I didn't know what happened to my son. I cried every day, not knowing where he was and if he was alive. And I knew, she said, that the terrorists, there was no way. I knew that my son loved doing mitzvahs. And the mitzvah that he loved to do more than anything else was the mitzvah of tefillin. He loved his tefillin. And I knew that there was no way that they, those terrorists, were going to allow him to wear his tefillin. And when I found out that he was killed the first day, I felt a partial consolation. At least my son didn't have to go one day without wearing tefillin. Could you imagine a mother making a statement like that? She lost a child, and she has a partial consolation because her son didn't have to go one day without wearing tefillin. And when I heard that, I felt every one of us in Klal Yisrael has to make a tikkun. We have to make an emendation. We must change. Especially the men that are wearing tefillin and the women when they're davening. And you know what I feel? I feel that from now on, from tonight on, when we daven, anytime you daven, you not only put the phone on vibrate, but we have to shut the phone. From now on, you have to shut the phone. And I made up a statement together, a slogan with two other guys, disconnect to reconnect. You have to disconnect your phone. It's not enough that it should be on vibrate. I'm telling you, if the women here would see how the men behave in shul, they would be appalled. The second Shemon Esra finishes, they got to take out their phone and see if they got an ad from Staples. Or if somebody wants to be connected on LinkedIn. Or if Mixbook is going to send an ad that they're going to get photos free or whatever. It's crazy how people are addicted today to cell phones. You know that I am a mohel, so you know that when I daven in a shul where there's a bris, we're supposed to say v'chori simay habris, together with the bal tefillah, I say one pasuk, he says the other, goes back and forth. In a shul that you all know that, of course, I won't say the name, I come up there to say v'chori simay habris, the bal tefillah's texting. I was going to smack the thing out of his hand. I said, who are you texting? God? You're the bal tefillah. How can you be texting? But it's true. People have lost control when it comes to texting and emails in shul. So from now on, from tonight on when you daven, it's not enough. Now, Mr. Goldberg, could you just bring me that box there? Because I brought a gift to everyone. That's right. Take out one or two for you. I want to show you. I was talking about this. Thank you. Good, thank you. I was talking about this in Brooklyn, and a young fellow made a poster for me. I'm going to give out every single one of them. You'll be able to have a sticker. Come, take a picture up close. It's disconnect to reconnect. It's an amazing little sticker. Put it on your refrigerator. Put it in your sitter. Put it on your stender. Now, I know it's a picture of a Sfard sitter, but I'm telling you, it works for Ashkenaz as well. Really. It works for everybody. And we're going to give it out right afterwards. Everybody should take one. And that's part of the tshuva that we're going to do in Elul. From now on, when it comes to davening, whether a woman is davening at home, a man is davening at shul, wherever you're davening, shut the phone. That's the disconnect. Ivri anochi. I am a Jew. I'm making a connection. And you know what occurred to me also? It's amazing. What do we say over and over and over? We say, Zochreinu l'chaim. Melachofetz b'chaim. Right? Hashem, please remember us for life. We want life. You're a king that wants life. Because Veinu b'sefer achayim, and write us in the sefer achayim. Why? Lamancha, for your sake. It's not that we want to live only for our sake. We want to be good Jews. We want to connect to Hashem. Every time you say Zachreinu, you know, we remember the first part. Because Veinu b'sefer achayim, lamancha l'kim chayim. Yeah, but why? Not only because you want to see your grandchildren, Well, not only because you want to be able to travel and do all the wonderful things in life. Lamancha, I want to be a good Jew. It's for your sake that I want life. Well, if it's your sake, so you got to connect to Hashem. How are you going to connect if you're connected to your cell phone and connected to texting and you can't go 5 minutes without it? So we have to learn disconnect to reconnect. There's another Kabbalah that I think that each of us should make this year. You know, you're not supposed to count Jews. Could be an Ayin Hara. That's why we count. If you want to count 10 Jews, you say Hashia Esamech Avarech, right? That's a pasuk of 10 words. Or some people who are not on a diet will say Baruch Atah Hashem Elokeinu Melech Olam Hamotzi Lechem Min Haaretz, right? And the poor woman who gets lechem is probably overweight, but whatever. But the idea is that it's 10 words, right? So when the Jews had to be counted, and Moshe Rabbeinu wanted to count them, they had to give a machzis hashekel. So now listen to what the pasuk tells us. It says, "Venosnu in Shmoy Slamed Pasuk Yud Beis. Venosnu ish koifer nafshei. Every person should give, and they shall give." Now, the Baal HaTurim picks up something very interesting. He says the word venosnu, you can read it forwards and backwards. Vav nun tof nun vav. Does anybody know what those words are called that you can read frontwards and backwards? Palindrome, right. A palindrome. And we all know words that are palindrome. Mom, pop, Aviva, race car, right? Natan. What? Natan? Yeah, very good. My daughter Aviva, A-V-I-V-A, right? I don't know why David and his father Yishai were both palindromes. There must be a medrash about that. But whatever. So why is Venosnu a palindrome? And the Baal HaTurim tells us something amazing. He says, if you read it backwards, it's also Venosnu, to teach you. Masha Adam Noisein Letztoka, that's which you give to somebody else for Tztoka. Whether your money or your talent or your time or your feelings, Yachzer Elav, it's going to come back to you. Don't feel that if you do something for somebody else, you're going to lose because of it. You're not going to miss anything when you give to somebody else. And that's what we have to make a Kabbalah. We have to make a Kabbalah. We have to undertake from now on, we're not going to live only for ourselves. We have to live for others. Every one of you, and I know so many of you, are blessed with certain talents. Every one of you has a different talent. Hashem gave you the talent, not that you should become rich and famous. Hashem gave you the talent so that you should give out to Klal Yisrael. So that you should give of your time and your energy and your chizuk to other people. That's what it's all about. And then when you need it, it'll be there for you. That's what Venosnu is all about. And if that's the case, who was the greatest giver of all? In my humble opinion, the greatest giver of all was a woman. A woman named Rachel Emenu. And you know something? There's a fabulous medrash in Eicha. In the beginning of Eicha, Perich of Dalad, in the introduction to Eicha Rabbah, it tells us that when Hashem saw that the Beis HaMikdash was being destroyed, Kavayochel Hashem cried, and he said, Yirmiya, get the avos to Davin. And Avram Davin said, Hashem, please stop the fires, save the Jews. Don't I have enough schusim? I was ready to give my son for the Akedah. And Hashem says, no, that's not enough. And then Yitzchok says, what about me? I was ready to give myself up on the Akedah. Isn't that enough? And Hashem said, no. And then Yaakov said, I suffered so much with Lavan and with Esav and my children. Isn't that enough? I had so much tzaris. No, that's not enough. And Moshe said, what about me? I gave up 40 years of my life to serve Klal Yisrael. And I'm not going into Eretz Yisrael because of them, because I tried to help them. Isn't that enough? And Hashem said, no. And finally, Rachel said, Hashem, why are you destroying the first Beis HaMikdash? Because you're jealous? Because they served Avodah Zarah? I wasn't jealous. I was a giver. I gave this simanim over, the signs over to Leah. So I was a giver. I wasn't jealous. Hashem, if I wasn't jealous, you shouldn't be jealous. And then the Medrash says, Miyad nizgalgalu rachamov shel HaKadosh Baruch Hu. The compassion of Hashem was awakened, and he said, "Bishvileich Rachel, because of you, the great giver, ani machzer es Yisrael l'mekomo, and I'm going to bring back Klal Yisrael to its place. And that's what the pasuk says in Yirmiyah. Koy amar Hashem, koy baroman nishma, I hear a voice on high, nehi b'chi samrurim, a bitter gevein, a bitter cry, rochel mavaker abanel, Rachel is crying, meyana linochem, she can't be consoled because the children are not there. And Hashem says, mini koylech mi bechi, remove your voice from crying, ve'inayach min dima, ki yesh socha lupulasech, because there's reward because of what you did. You are the greatest giver. You gave the simonim. Now, I want to tell you a vort I heard just a few weeks ago. Rabbi Noach Isaac Olbaum, we all know him from our neighborhood right here in Queens. He quoted it from a wonderful, wonderful sefer called Tiferes Uziel. This is one of the greatest insights you'll ever hear. It's such a fabulous insight from a Hasidish Rav. It's amazing. All of us who have learned Gemara know that there's an expression, Aveda, a lost item, Chozeres, is returned b'simonim, with signs. In other words, if let's say you lose a wallet, so and somebody finds it, they're going to give it to you only if you can show that you had a sign on it, that you know either it had a certain mark on it or there were certain things in it. You have to give a simon, you have to give a sign that it's yours. You lose a coat, you can tell somebody, you know, I know it's my coat because it's got a rip on the inner pocket or it's got gold buttons. So you give a simon and then you can get the Aveda back. Said the Tiferes Uziel, something fabulous. Aveda, Chozeres b'simonim, an object that's lost can be returned with simonim. And he says, Aveda, what was the greatest loss that Klal Yisrael ever had? The loss of the Beis HaMikdash. Chozeres, how does it come back? B'simonim, with the signs that Rachel gave to Leah. Isn't that fabulous? Aveda Chozeres b'simonim. Because she was a giver. And you know something? If she was a giver, Hashem, of course, is the greatest giver. We know every day we say that Hashem, he gives our heart the capacity to understand. Hashem gave us the Torah. Hashem gives us strength every day that we're able to wake up and continue on with life. So if that's the case, I believe that all of us have to become givers and plant seeds. And I want to tell you a great story that happened with me a number of years ago. It was the first time that I was in Manchester. And I was about to give a speech for 500 women. I'm about to leave the house where I was staying. And somebody says to me, wait, before you go to the auditorium, you got to go visit somebody. I said, who do I got to go visit? There's 500 women waiting. He says, no. There's somebody that's waiting for you. She's a brilliant woman, but she's very, very sick. Her name is Rebbetzin Chavi Wachshal. She's a young woman with MS, and she's paralyzed. She's in a wheelchair. And she wants you to come just for 2 minutes on the way to the auditorium. So how do you say no to somebody who's in a wheelchair and is asking that you should come by for 2 minutes? So I come into the house. There's 25 women sitting around the table waiting that she should come in to give a share. She wasn't in the room yet. And then they open up a curtain and they wheel her in. And she comes in the wheelchair. And she says to me, Rabbi Krohn, I need a favor from you. I said, what do you think? I'm thinking, how am I going to say no matter what she asks me in front of all these people? That's a woman in a wheelchair, right? So I said, what can I do for you? She said, I know that you're a writer and that you've written a couple of books, but now I'm writing a book. I'm writing a book about all my travails. And I've gone through so many difficulties with my illness. And Rav Segel, who lives here in Manchester, has come many times to give me chizuk. And I wrote down everything that he said. Rav Brevda has come to give me chizuk, and I wrote down what he said. And I got chizuk and encouragement from many secular sources, and I'm putting it all together, and I'm writing a book called Facing Adversity with Faith. And I need you to write me a letter for the book. I said, you know, I appreciate the compliment, but you know, you got to be a big tzaddik to write a letter like this. I I'm not that type of person. I can't write a letter for you for that book. And she says, no, it's going to mean so much. Please read the book and write me the letter. Okay, I said, look, obviously I can't read the book right now and I can't write the letter right now. If you have a hard copy of the book, I'll take it home. I'll read it on the plane. I'll read it in New York. And I figured from New York, I'll call her up and I'll say, you know, I'm not interested in doing it, but at least I could say no over the phone. You can't say no in person. Anyhow, I take the manuscript and I start reading it on the plane and I can't stop crying. just the pain and the anguish that this woman goes through every single day. One of the things that breaks your heart when you read the book is her description of her daughter's eighth grade graduation. She's coming to the graduation in a wheelchair, and she knows that all the other girls are so proud of their mothers. Everybody comes in, everybody looks so nice and dressed so beautifully. The daughters are proud of the mothers are proud of the daughters. And here she's coming in with a sickly mother who's a young woman. She's got a daughter in the eighth grade and in a wheelchair. The daughter's embarrassed for the mother's embarrassed for the daughter who's embarrassed. It's awful. It's just awful. And you just cry from one page to the other as she explains how her illness was deteriorating and how her body was deteriorating. And then she has a sentence in that book that changed my life. She has a sentence that is so great. I'd like to read it to you. It's from a secular source. She says where she got it from, and I'd like to read it to you. Listen to this thought. Any fool can count the seeds in one apple. You don't have to be a big chacham to count the seeds, right? In an apple, you open up an apple, you count the seeds, four, five seeds, whatever. But only the highest power, Hashem, can count the apples in one seed. Think of that. You don't have to be a big wise person to count the seeds in one apple, but only Hashem knows how many apples can grow from one seed. When you plant the seed of friendship, when you plant the seed of encouragement, you plant the seed of money or give someone a job, and you give them a seed of chizuk, that person can blossom. It changes their life. They can build a whole family. They build a whole community. When you give that chizuk that the person needed for that moment. And I called her up and I said, Rebbetzin, this is not a book. This is a sefer kodesh ad miyoyd. And if you would allow me, I'll be honored to write a letter for you. And of course, I wrote the letter. You could all get the book. It's published by Feldheim. It's called Facing Adversity with Faith. And she told me she wrote it under a pen name M.L. Kramer. Kramer is the Goyen's last name, the Vilna Goyen. She's a descendant from the Goyen. She just didn't want people to know that she wrote it because people would call and write, and she's just too exhausted and drained to answer all the letters or all the calls that she would get. But it's a fabulous book. But I want to tell you what it means to plant seeds and see how apples grow. This past winter, I was at a bar mitzvah in the Five Towns. And Rabbi Mordechai Yaffe, who is today the menial of a yeshiva called May, Masifta Teres Yaakov, told me this fabulous, fabulous story. In Ontario, 20 miles below Toronto, there's a town called Hamilton. And in Hamilton, in 1950s, there were three shuls. A small, insignificant Orthodox shul. The rabbi was a man by the name of Rabbi Mordechai Green. He was a short little man. He spoke Yiddish. That's why probably he got the job, because everybody in that old shul spoke Yiddish. They came from Europe. It's a beautiful conservative shul and a beautiful reform shul. And the young couples, the young people, were not going to the Orthodox shul. So Rabbi Green knew very well that he better build a gorgeous Orthodox shul. Otherwise, he's not getting the people. So he goes to the Royal Bank of Canada, and he asks to speak to the bank manager. And the bank manager is a tall Episcopalian, a goyish fellow named Mr. Amy. And Mr. Amy says, can I help you? He says, yeah, I'd like to talk to you. He says, sit down. And Rabbi Green sits down, and he says to him, I'd like to build a synagogue, and I need $150,000. Now, $150,000 is a lot of money today. Imagine what it was in the early 1950s. Now, he didn't want to say that he wanted to build an Orthodox synagogue, because he knew Mr. Amy is a banker. Obviously, he knows there's not Orthodox people that are wealthy. How's he ever going to get paid? So he tried to avoid using the word Orthodox. So Mr. Amy said to him, what do you want to do? He said, I want to build a Jewish house of worship. And then Mr. Amy said, yeah, but what denomination? So now he had no choice. He said, I'm an Orthodox rabbi, and I want to build an Orthodox synagogue. And Mr. Amy just stopped, and he put his hand on his chin, and he just stared at Rabbi Green. He just stared at him. And Rabbi Green noticed suddenly that tears were coming down Mr. Amy's eyes, and he was crying. He said, I'll give you the money. You'll be able to build a synagogue. But I want to tell you why. He said, when I was a little boy, at the end of the 1920s, I lived in Timmins, Ontario. I looked it up. Timmins is 400 miles north of Hamilton. He said, at the end of the 1920s, my father was killed in a fire. I was a little boy. I was left with my mother and my brothers and my sister, and we were so poverty-stricken. And in that town of Timmins, there was a general store. Now, you know, in the small towns, there's a general store that sells everything, clothing, food, hardware, everything. He said it was owned by an Orthodox Jew, a man by the name of Sam Bukovetsky. And one day, Mr. Bukovetsky came into my mother, and he said, Mrs. Amy, I want you to know, as long as I own this store, your children will have clothes. You can come in anytime. I will never ask you for money. You can pay me whenever you want, but I will never ask you for money. As long as I own this store, your children will have clothes. And he said, Mrs. Amy, as long as I own this store, your children will have food. You come every day and get what you need. I will never ask you for money. Whenever you want, you can pay me back. Mr. Amy was still crying, and he said, I want you to know, the only reason my family survived was because of that Orthodox Jew. I was able to go through school and go through college and become a bank manager. And when I saw you through the window, it occurred to me, I'll bet this guy is an Orthodox Jew. And he said to himself, Mr. Amy said, I said, you know, it's about time I paid back Sam Bukovetsky for what he did to my family. And when you said you were an Orthodox rabbi and you wanted to build an Orthodox synagogue, I knew that God sent you. Could you imagine? So a shul, a gorgeous shul, which is still there today. Today, Rabbi Mordechai Green's son, Rabbi Daniel, should have a refuah shleima. He is the rabbi there. But you know what's amazing? Not only was an Orthodox shul built and people became frum because they went to that shul, Rabbi Yaffe, who is the menahel of Masifta Ateres Yaakov, tells the boys in his class, in his school of 300 kids, he said, I remained frum because of that shul, because I grew up in Hamilton. And he says, I'm not embarrassed to tell you that my father was a survivor and he would not let me go to a yeshiva. He was afraid to send me out of town. There was no yeshiva in Hamilton. So till I was 17, I was in public school. The only reason I remained frum was because of that shul. When I was 17, my father said I could go to Nei Yisrael in Toronto. And he told me, Rabbi Yaffe said, he tells the boys all the time, look at me, I'm a menahel of 300 boys in the five towns. And I started when I was 17. Imagine what you guys can do when you started in the first grade. Imagine that. Look at the apples that Mr. Bukovetsky planted for himself. He's shuling the Olam HaEmes. But look how many people remained frum. Look how a young man became a Rebbe, a menahel of a yeshiva. And how much Torah he's taught, and how much Torah Rabbi Green was able to teach, and his son was able to teach. Why? Because of the seeds that Mr. Bukovetsky planted. And that means that when you do chesed, you do to a goy as well, not only to a yid. I just got back from a fabulous, fabulous trip. I wish I could take all of you to Hungary, Austria, and Prague. I got back just less than a week ago. And one of the places that we went to in Hungary was the kever of a very, very big tzaddik, a kind, caring tzaddik. His name was Rabshaya Karastira, from that town of Karastir. And one of the things that he was noted for was the chesed that he did for every person who came, even goyim. And when you do a chesed, v'nosnu, when you do, eventually you're going to get it back. Sometimes it'll take years, and if you don't get it back, your children or grandchildren won't get it back. But there's no such thing as planting a seed of chesed and it not coming back. And that's what we have to undertake. And you want to hear one of the greatest seeds that was ever planted? You wouldn't believe. This happened, I spoke to the person himself. Today he's an elderly gentleman. He was a young man when it happened. His name was Herschel Weber. He grew up in Williamsburg. He was learning in a kollel, and he told me. He was learning in Williamsburg. One day he's coming down, like he's going home for lunch, and he's walking down the stairs of the kollel, and he sees a guy in the street say, oh, I have a pain, and the guy falls. Now, he didn't know anything about medicine, so he's yelling for the police to come, the fire department to come, or whatever, and everybody's yelling and screaming, somebody to get help. And by the time the police came, the poor guy died. And Herschel Weber told me, he said, you know what was the most painful thing of all? I heard one police officer say to the other, if we would have got here 5 minutes ago, we could have saved this guy. So he decides on his own that he is going to learn first aid He's going to take a course, and he's going to get a little oxygen tank, carry it with him. And he had two other friends, and I just want to mention their name because they have a great schus, a guy, Mr. Galant, who had a cleaning store, and Mr. Kaff, who had a bakery, and they all went to first aid to learn emergency medicine, and they had these little oxygen, little tanks that they carried in case of an emergency. And everybody in Williamsburg knew that if there's an emergency, you call Herschel Weber. Listen to this. One night, there's a woman. She's sleeping with her husband. She's, I don't know, close to 90. In the morning, she wakes up. Tries to talk to her husband. He doesn't answer. And she shakes him. He's not moving. And she begins to realize, oh my gosh, he must have died overnight. She can't believe it. And she tries to push him and talk to him, and he's not moving. And she runs to the front window. She's yelling and screaming at 7 o'clock in the morning. And everybody yells, get Herschel Weber, get Herschel Weber. And of course, he comes running. And he told me by the time he got up there, he saw the guy died 5 hours ago. There's nothing he could do. And Nebuch, this poor woman, is crying, and he sits down and he talks to her. He tries to comfort her a bit. And then he told me this. He walked outside, and now there was a whole crowd that gathered there. And he told me the amazing thing. And I'm going to tell you exactly how he told it to me, even though I realize that I'm on video and it's going to be known all over the whole world. But I didn't want to print it exactly this way because it's so cruel. But I'm going to tell it to you anyway. He said, as he was walking down, there was a big crowd, and he overhears one Yid say to another. Now, I'm going to say it in Yiddish because that's how it happened, and I'll translate. And he said like this. He heard one Yid say, "Dezes dem shigena Herschel, etim geharget." You see that crazy guy Herschel? He killed him. Now, that was dumb. It wasn't true. But what he meant to say, this guy was right. Herschel Weber doesn't know any medicine. He probably went up there thinking he could save the guy. He should have got a real doctor. But Herschel Weber knew that's not true. The guy died 5 hours ago. But he told me that when he heard that one Yid could say that about another Yid, he told me he went home, he cried, he could not stop crying. How could one Jew say that about him? How could one Jew say that about anybody? That another Jew killed somebody? He was trying to do a good thing. So listen to this. The next day he goes to the Satmar Rebbe. And he says to the Rebbe, you know, Rebbe, I think that it's time that we should have an organization that knows emergency medicine. And anytime when there's emergency, that people should be available to help. So the Rebbe says, bring me a Shari Tshuva. Now the Shari Tshuva is a famous sefer written by Rabbeinu Yonah. And you could look it up. You will not believe this. Shari Tshuva, Shar Gimel, Ois Ayin Aleph. Note 71, listen to what the Satmar Rebbe read to Herschel Weber. And he tells him like this, here it is. V'toiv v'nochayn ma'oid, it is proper, liyois b'chol ir v'ir, there should be in every city, misnatvim ba'am, volunteers, minam askilim, get intelligent volunteers, don't get people that are dumb. Get people that are intelligent and capable. Liyois nochaynim umuzumanim, they should be ready, l'chol devar hatzolah. The Rebbe says, name it Hatzalah. And that's how Hatzalah started. Could you believe? Herschel Weber, one man, saw a guy die, and he went and he got first aid. He went to learn first aid, and then he realized he had to do something more, and he went to the Rebbe, and the Rebbe showed him the Shari Tshuva, and he said, call it Hatzalah, because that's what the Shari Tshuva says. You got to be ready, l'chol dvar Hatzalah. Is there anybody here, anybody who's going to watch this video, any place in the United States, that hasn't been helped, or knows somebody that hasn't been helped because of Hatzalah? Imagine the apples of Herschel Weber that he planted with that one seed to go to the Rebbe and ask for advice because he cared. Because he did something. And when a person does something, then Hashem sees, you tried, I'm going to help you. But before I go to the next part, I got to tell you my three favorite Hatzalah stories. These are the greatest. They'll never be printed, but they're the greatest. The first one happened in Flatbush a couple years ago, Yom Kippur. It was late in the afternoon. They were davening Musaf in a small shul. The air conditioning wasn't working. It was very, very hot. And there was an old man there who probably should not have been fasting. But he was a tzaddik, so he decided he's going to fast. And then he collapsed, and people thought he died. So they called out a code blue. A code blue means that somebody, there's a life and death situation. So all the guys from Hatzalah and all the shuls of Flatbush, they whipped off their talisim and they come running into this shul and they spread out everyone and they take a stretcher and they put this guy on the stretcher and they bring him out to the fresh air. And when the guy is in the fresh air, He opens up his eyes and he sees all these guys standing around with white kitlach, everybody around him. And he says in Yiddish, "Bin ich schon oben? Am I upstairs already?" He thought he was, you know, surrounded by angels. He really was surrounded by angels. These Hatzalah guys really are angels. Here's a second story. You won't believe it. Hatzalah has such sophisticated machinery and telephone services that they know in a second where the call is coming from. Because if somebody is so frantic and can't give the right address, they still want to be able to get there. So they got a call one night from a guy in Spanish Harlem, and the guy's yelling and screaming, and they can't make out what this guy, what he wants, and they're trying to calm him down, but he's screaming. And Spanish Harlem, who wants to be caught in Spanish Harlem? So they don't send one unit, they send three units, because who knows, a guy is stuck in Spanish Harlem, who knows what's happening? Anyhow, they send three units, they come running upstairs, and they open up the door, and this Chinese guy is yelling his head off. And they're wondering, what is going on? And finally, they figure out. You see, Hatzalah advertises on cartons of Chol of Yisrael. And this Chinese guy, by mistake, bought a bottle of Chol of Yisrael, and the milk was sour. So he called a number because he was complaining about the milk. That's why he was so yelling. And here's the third story, and this is probably the most important one, because it's very important to know, even though it's pretty funny. But it happened. And it happened with Dove Rowe. Some of you know Dove Rowe was the head of Hatzalah here in Queens for many years. And his great son, Ellie, of course, took over. But this happened when he was first starting in Hatzalah. He was on a plane back from Eretz Yisrael, El Al. You know, one of these 1 o'clock flights, and it's dark at night, and everybody's sleeping. And now it's 3-4 hours into the trip, and they're over the Atlantic Ocean. And suddenly somebody has a heart problem. And they run up to the pilot, and the pilot announces, "Is there a medic on board? Is there a doctor on board?" And, you know, Dovro was in Hatzalah, but he's not a doctor, so he didn't come forward. But then again, a few minutes later, the pilot says again, "We need a doctor. There's a heart situation on board." So he comes running up. He says, "Look, I'm not a doctor, but I'm a, you know, a paramedic. I work for Hatzalah." He says, "Call Hatzalah in Williamsburg in Brooklyn, and they'll tell you what you have to do." So the pilot, you know, in those days you could get up to the pilot. So the pilot calls Hatzalah in Williamsburg. The guy in Williamsburg asks, "Who is this?" He says, "It's El Al." He said, "What do you mean El Al?" And he hangs up. Like, what is this, a joke? So then Dovro says, "No, call him back. Tell him I'm Q9. Q9, they don't understand. This is a real thing. So he calls back and says, "I'm Q9. So he says, "Oh, I'm sorry." He says, "Let me tell you what to do." It's amazing. He said, "Wake up every woman on that flight." He said, "A plane that's traveling from Israel is a walking drugstore. Every woman, if you open her pocketbook, any medication that you need is going to be in somebody's pocketbook." And sure enough, they woke up all the women and they found epinephrine and they saved this guy. So it's good to know, if you ever need any medication, just wake up the women on board. I'm telling you, leave the men alone. Now listen to this. When they landed in Halifax, you know, because that's the first place where you could land in Canada, right? They had to land right away and get this guy to the hospital. So the pilot announces, "You know, we're about to land because of this situation with the, you know, with the heart attack that the guy had on board." So the lady cardiologist wakes up and says, "Hey, I'm a cardiologist. Why didn't anybody wake me up?" She slept through the whole thing. Could have avoided the whole thing. But whatever it is, it's not the point. The point is, just remember, if you ever need any medication, you know where to find it. But I want to tell you a great story. A great story about somebody that many of you know. And his name is Yehuda Zakatinsky, a tremendous tzaddik who lives in our neighborhood. Again, the best people in the world live in Queens. So those people in TorahAnytime.com shouldn't feel bad about it wherever they hear this, but come live in Queens, you'll see. But anyway, so Yehuda Zakatinsky has this wonderful organization called Hashivenu, and he does Kirov all over. And recently he got a call from a Rosh Yeshiva. Obviously, I can't say the name of the Rosh Hashiva. Says to him, "Listen, Rabbi Zakatinsky, I have a son who's going off the derech. And he's in a certain college. Is there any way that you could go and learn with him and try to bring him back and try to inspire him?" And Rabbi Zakatinsky says, "Of course I'll do it. What's the question? Of course I'll be happy to do it. Just tell me what college he's in and I'll go. Because I never refuse to inspire or to try to help somebody who needs help." And then he says to Rosh Yeshiva, let me tell you why I do it, why I would never say no. He said, when I was a young boy, I grew up in New Haven, Connecticut. Now, in New Haven, Connecticut, they didn't have yeshivas like you have in New York and in New Jersey today. And I went to a high school, which I'm not going to say where. He said, I went to a high school, and I was behind, because after all, I came from a place where I had a weaker background. And I felt terrible that I was falling behind in class. And one day, on Shabbos, I decided, I'm going to go to the older boys in the Beis Medrash and ask them to learn with me, because I had to catch up. I needed some extra training. And I went to one guy, and the first guy said to me, I'm so sorry, I just don't have the time. I have a chavrus on Shabbos, we learned something special, I just don't have the time. So I went to a second guy, and the second guy said, I'm so sorry, but, you know, I try to learn a certain masechta, I only learned that masechta on Shabbos, so I just don't have the time. He said, I went from boy to boy in the Beis Medrash, the older guys, and nobody had time for me. And there was one guy left, and I said to myself, if this guy doesn't learn with me, Sunday I'm leaving the yeshiva. And I went to that fellow in the Beis Medrash. I said, please, I'm from New Haven, I'm falling behind, could you please help me? And that fellow put his arm around me. He said, of course I'll help you, sit down, let's learn together. And we learned for a little while, and the next Shabbos, that fellow came over to me, and he said, you want to learn again? I'll be happy to learn with you. And that person gave me tremendous chizuk, and I swore to myself that day that I will never refuse anybody if they want to learn with me. And he said to the Rosh Yeshiva, you know who that fellow was who learned with me? He said, that was you. He said, what? He said, didn't you go to that yeshiva? He said, of course I did. He said, but I don't remember it. He said, how could you remember? You probably learned with everybody who asked you. So I was just one of the many. But that's Vinosnu. Here, that Rosh Yeshiva 35 years ago gave this kid the time of day, and now this Rabbi Zakatinsky hopefully will be able to bring back his son. And I want to tell you one more great story, and then we're going to review and end with a story that will change your life forever. I just heard this story recently on the trip that I told you we went to Hungary, Austria, and Prague. There was a fellow, let's call him Rab Nachman. He's a regular American boy, went to yeshiva, went into business, and moved to Israel. And every once in a while, he would come back to America to do business. And he had a cousin who lived in Miami. And the cousin in Miami, strangely enough, was an Israeli who moved from Israel to America. So here Nachman moved from America to Israel, a frum guy with a frum family. But his cousin, who was not religious, moved from Israel, moved to Miami. So every time Nachman went to Miami, he would always go visit his cousin, even though he knew he couldn't eat in his house, and the Israeli cousin respected that. He would get him food from a kosher restaurant, he'd put out paper plates, and they were able to have a meal in his house. This happened a couple of times. Every few years he came back to Miami, came to visit him. Recently he comes to Miami, and he sees this Israeli guy, his cousin, is wearing a kippah, and he sees all the doors in the house have a mezuzah. And he walks into the dining room, he sees their svarim there. And he says, what happened? Did you become religious? He said, yeah, I became religious a while ago, since you saw me last. He said, what happened? He said, let me tell you what happened. He said, one afternoon I was sitting on my porch with my wife, it's a very hot day, and I noticed crowds and crowds of people, they're all walking down towards the beach. I realized they're Orthodox Jews. Then I realized, oh my gosh, it's Rosh Hashanah. I didn't even realize it's Rosh Hashanah. These guys are going to Tashlich. I remember Tashlich as a child. I don't know what possessed me, but I decided I'm going. I went back into the house, I got a kippah, put it on my head, and I followed all the people. I didn't have a sitter, I didn't know what to say. But, you know, I read Hebrew, and, you know, people saw that my kippah is just like planted on my head. So somebody came over to me and said, you want to read the Tashlich service? He said, yeah, I'm Israeli, I could read it. He said, I started reading it. And then when I finished, obviously, you know, there was another person standing by who realized, you know, that I was a newcomer to this. He said to me, did you hear shofar today? He said, no. He said, you know, I happen to have the shofar with me. Would you want me to blow shofar for you? I said, yeah, that'd be nice. I haven't heard shofar in years. And right by the water, the guy blew, you know, Tkia, Shram, Trua, Tkia, he blew the shofar for me. And then just as we were about to part, he said, you know, my name is Moshe Katz. And I was thinking like, who cares? You know, but my name is Moshe Katz, and if you ever need me, you know, you could find me in the synagogue. And that's it. I came home. I came home, I tell my wife the story. She said, you know, you won't believe it. I came there, and there was a guy, he had a shofar, and he blew for me. And then at the end he said, his name is Moshe Katz. And his wife said, what'd you say his name is? He said, Moshe Katz. Why? She began sweating. She said, you won't believe it. Our maiden name before my father changed it in Israel was Katz. My grandfather, Moshe Katz, was the Baal Tekeah in Bialystok. He blew shofar in Bialystok. I can't believe it. You met a guy, Moshe Katz. My grandfather died a long time ago. And here this guy, Moshe Katz, blew shofar for you. I can't believe it. And they both got the chills. They couldn't believe it. And they felt, you know, this must be a sign from heaven. So he said, slowly but surely, we went back to the synagogue eventually. We got in contact with this Moshe Katz, who got us in contact with the rabbi. And that's how we came back to being religious. And this Rav Nachman, he was absolutely floored. He couldn't believe it. He goes back to Eretz Yisrael, and the next time he goes to visit Rav Chaim Kanievsky, he tells Rav Chaim Kanievsky this story, and he says, Rebbe, do you believe this story? He said, of course I believe it. These things happen with tzaddikim all the time. He says, Rebbe, I want to ask you a question. If Hashem wanted to send this Moshe Katz to inspire this guy by blowing shofar, why didn't he do it 10 years ago? This Moshe Katz has been in Miami for a long time. So has my cousin. Listen to what Rav Chaim said. Rav Chaim said, Hashem waits for somebody to take the first step, and then he takes the second step. When Hashem saw that this guy went to Tashlech, he said, you took the first step? Okay, now I'll send you Moshe Katz. But we have to take the first step. And when I heard this, I could not get over it. You know why? Because there's a fabulous Medrash. And the Medrash tells us that Kaviyachol Hashem and Klal Yisrael have an argument. Hashem says to the Jewish people in Malachi Gimel Pasuk Zayin, Shuvu Elai, you return to me, V'ashuv Aleichem, and I'll return to you. You return to me, you take the first step. And you know what we say to Hashem? No, Hashem. Hashiveinu Hashem Elecha V'nashuva. That's the last Pasuk in Eicha. Hashiveinu Hashem, you return V'nashuva, then we'll come back to you. We say to God, you take the first step. God says, no, you take the first step. And you know something? Tonight, before you go to sleep, open up an Eicha. The last Pasuk, you'll see an amazing thing. The hay is missing in the word v'nashuva. That's the last pasuk in Eicha. Why is the hay missing? We read it v'nashuva because it's a kametz beis, v'nashuva. Why is the hay missing? You know why? I'll tell you why, what I think. Because the hay is a letter of tshuva. That door is always open. But if God needs that he takes the first step, then it's not complete. Then the v'nashuva is not complete. So the hay is missing because the tshuva is not complete. Hashem needs we have to take the first step. That's what we have to do, just like that Israeli did. When he went to Tashlech, then Hashem said, okay, you took the first step, I'll send Moshe Katz. Heshel Weber went to the Satmar Rebbe. He went to learn first aid. Hashem said, you know something? You went, I'll take you. I'll give you such schusim, you'll have more apples than anybody else in the whole America. How many apples does he have? Because he took the first step. That's the lesson that we have to learn tonight. We're all going to enter that door. But we have to take the first step. We take the first step by disconnecting our phones tonight when it comes to davening. And then not even vibrate. That's not good enough. Because when you vibrate, when that phone vibrates, then you want to find out what's going on. And it's hard to daven with an iPhone. Also because, you know, you see the phone call coming in. I'm not telling you not to daven with an iPhone if that's the only sitter you have. I remember one year we went on a trip to Italy, and Menachem Nissel, a dear friend of mine, Mrs. Butler, I think you also know Menachem Nissel, right, a great teacher in Eretz Yisrael. So he said a great word about printing Svarim. He said, you know, the first Svarim were printed in Italy, and there's a Kedusha of Svarim. Today, people are adopting in iPhones, but thank God they're not kissing it. At least not yet, anyway. But the idea is we have to disconnect to reconnect. Let's remember the story, Ivri Anochi. I am a Jew. That's what Rav Elvel Soloveitchik said. That's how you answer. That's what the hay is all about. That's why Avram and Sarai got the hay, because they were the father and mother of all those people who did Baal Tshuva. Now, I want to tell you something. I see in my notes that I forgot to tell it to you. It's so incredible. I'm so glad I wrote it down. You know that story that I told you about Naftali and the tefillin? You know what Rabbi Yaron Halbertal told me from Darkei Torah when I started talking about disconnect to reconnect? Naftali, Nun, Pei, Tof, Lamed, Yud is the same letters as tefillin. Could you believe it? Tof, Pei, Lamed, Yud, Nun. You could go crazy from that. That mitzvah that his mother said was his mitzvah, that's the one that he loved most, that was in his name. Naftali is the letters tefillin. We owe it to him to make a tikkun when we're wearing tefillin, to shut our phones and disconnect, to be able to reconnect. Let's remember v'nosnu, let's become givers, because when we give, we're going to get back. Rachel was the greatest giver, Hashem said, because of that, he's going to give back the Beis HaMikdash. Let's remember, any fool can count the seeds in one apple, but only Hashem, the greatest, highest power, can count the apples in one seed. And we know, we see from Sam Bukovetsky, from the seeds that he planted by supporting that family. Let's remember that we have to take the first step, just like Herschel Weber did, just like that fellow in Miami did when he went to Tashlich. And let's remember, if we don't take the first step, then the tshuva is not complete. The hay is missing in Vinashuva. I just want to end with this fabulous story and great, great lesson. Most of us here are certainly old enough to remember Vietnam, one of the greatest fiascos that the United States was ever involved in. We lost so many soldiers in that terrible, terrible war. In that war, there was a Navy jet fighter pilot by the name of Captain Plum. Captain Plum was a sophisticated jet fighter pilot who flew from the Kitty Hawk outside Hanoi, and he flew the F-4, which is the most sophisticated fighter plane at the time, fighter jet fighter plane at the time, and he flew 74 missions. They're called sorties. He had one more to fly, a 75th one, and 5 days later, he was going to come back to America. And on the 75th mission, his plane was shot down, it exploded. He was able to get out with a parachute. He landed, unfortunately, in enemy territory, and he was a prisoner of war that was tortured for 5 long years. He had one flight left. That was the last flight, but he saved his life because of the parachute. He landed in enemy territory, and he was a prisoner of war. After 5 long years, he came back to America, and he became a very famous public speaker. And one night, he writes, he was in Kansas City, and he was in a restaurant, and he was eating alone. And on the other side of the restaurant, there was another man eating alone who was staring at him. It's very uncomfortable when you're alone and somebody's staring at you. And finally, the man who was staring at Captain Plum comes over to him and says, "You're Captain Plum, aren't you?" He says, "Yes, sir, but how do you know that?" He said, "You are on the Kitty Hawk, and you flew 74 missions. Is that not correct?" He said, "Yes, sir, but how do you know that?" He said, "I know your 75th mission, the parachute opened and saved your life. Is that not true?" He said, "Yes, sir, but how do you know that?" And the man says, "I was a sailor on the Kitty Hawk, and I packed your parachute." And he could not believe it. He said, and they begin talking, and he begins to see this guy was really on the Kitty Hawk, and he packed his parachute. And he said, Captain Plum said, "Do you know how many times I've prayed for you and your family because you saved my life?" And they began into a whole discussion. And then when Captain Plum left the restaurant, he felt awful. And you know what he writes? You know why he says he felt awful? He said, "I bet I saw that sailor 100 times on the Kitty Hawk, but I never said good morning to him because I was a jet fighter pilot. He was only a sailor. But he packed my parachute. I owed him to say good morning. I owed him to say thank you. I owed him to be courteous to him." And Captain Plum writes, "There's many people that pack our parachutes, and we forget about them. Our parents, our teachers, our rabbonim. Do we ever say thank you to all these people? We think, no, everything's coming to us. But there's so many people who have packed our parachutes, and we owe them a karas atayv. And that's what Elul is all about. Anila Doidi Vadoidi Li. Let's think about all those people who got us to where we are today. Did we ever say thank you? Do we ever acknowledge them? Do we ever validate them? And I was wondering, is this a Jewish concept? And then I remembered something that happened to me when I was 15 years old. When I was 15 years old, my father, Shalom, was a great Talmud Chacham. He wasn't a Rav in a shul, but every Tuesday night he would go to the Mariah shul and hear a shir from Yosher Ber Soloveitchik. And all the RCA rabbis would go there as well. You know why? Because Rav Yosher Ber would teach Gemara for an hour, and for 15 minutes he would say Drush on the Parsha, and every Rav had his speech for that coming Shabbos. So the place was packed. So my father says to me one Tuesday night, come with me. I want you to hear how Rabbi Yosher Ber gives a shir. So he took me and my grandfather, and we come to the Mariah Shul. Now, I just remember that they learned Masechta Megillah. I don't remember what they learned, but I will never, ever forget the drush that Rabbi Yosher Ber said that night. And for years, years, I wanted to see. I tried to find out if it was true scientifically and biologically, and it's 1,000%. Listen to this. It was Parshas Vayishlach, and he said like this. In Bereishis Lamed Hei Pasuk Ches and Tes, it tells us, Vatomos Devoira Meinekes Rivka. Devoira, the maidservant of Rivka, died, and Yaakov gives her a big hesped. He calls the place Alon Bochus, the plain of crying. And then, Vayera Alakim Al Yaakov Od. Hashem comes back to Yaakov and visits him a second time. Rabbi Yosher Ber, who's Devoira? We never heard of her before or afterwards. Why is Yaakov giving this big hesped, and Hashem is coming back to visit him a second time? And Rabbi Yosher Ber said something genius. He said, Devora is a bee, a queen bee. And a queen bee gets nectar from a flower and has to bring it back to the hive. But a queen bee will never, ever land on a flower unless it knows it can get nectar from that flower. It could go over 100 flowers, but it knows there's a certain aroma that it senses from that flower that it can get nectar from. That's the only one it lands on, and that's the one it draws the nectar and brings it back to the hive. And I have a friend, Danny Center, who's not a biologist, that's not what you call it, but whatever it is, I know that he raises bees. I've been to his hives. He's got 80,000 bees. And he told me that's exactly what this queen bee does. And Rabbi Yosher Ber said, this Devora was in a house of Rishayim. Lavan, Lavan's wife, Besuel's wife, but she landed on Rivka, because she knew this is the one that I can develop. This is the one that I can draw nectar from. And Yaakov knew this Devora packed his mother's parachute. And that's why the Ramban says, Yaakov said to Devora, you know what? You're getting older. I'm leaving Lavan. Come with me. We'll take care of you for the rest of your life. And Devora traveled with Yaakov. And Yaakov knew that Rivka packed his parachute, because Yitzchak didn't like Yaakov the way he liked Esav. So Yaakov knew that Devora packed Rivka's parachute, and Rivka packed Yaakov's parachute. That's why he gave us such a great hesped. And when Hashem saw that Yaakov has hakaras hatoiv, Vayera Elokim El Yaakov, that's why Hashem came back to Yaakov. That's what Rabbi Yosher Ber said. And that's the final lesson as we come to Elul. Anila doidi v'doidi li means not only that we are close to Hashem, and as much as we recognize what Hashem does for us, Hashem will recognize the good that we do. But anila doidi v'doidi li has been adam l'chaverei as well. There are many people out there who packed our parachutes. Let's not forget to say thank you. Let's not forget to call them before Rosh Hashanah. Maybe we didn't give them enough kavod. We didn't give them enough recognition. We didn't give them enough validation. That's a way to bring Klal Yisrael together. And when Klal Yisrael is together, that's when Hashem says, when you are by Aguda Achas, that's when I'm going to bring Mashiach. Hashem should bless every single one of us. We should disconnect to reconnect. All of you come. We're going to give out these posters, these stickers to everyone. Let's remember Ivri Anoichi. Let's be proud that we're Yidden, and make sure that Hashem knows that we're proud that we're Yidden, and we'll be Zeicha to Ashnaz Geula v'Yeshua, only Simchas and Mazel and good health. Thank you for inviting me, and thank you for listening.